On today's Men of the Apes, I'm just refreshing Pocket Casts over and over to see yesterday's episode show up.
Hello and welcome to Men of the Apes, the daily podcast, where we break down every minute of the Planet of the Apes movies, 1 minute at a time, and I just had the most brilliant decision in the whole world. I know what soundbite I want to include in the theme song next time.
Oh, dee.
Stabba dabba baba dabba. I may have to put that in there somewhere. All right, here we are, minute 67. We're enjoying the fact that as soon as we wrapped 66 just moments ago, we went ahead and posted it. So we're waiting to see how quickly that goes. We're doing this real time. Yeah. I don't know about you guys, but I kind of feel legit all of a sudden that we're doing it and posting it out there.
So yeah, it's on YouTube already. It might be on Facebook. Who knows?
Well, if you're listening to yesterday's and are you're listening to today and you're you, forget it, that's all too confusing, it's hurting my head to even get into that. Yeah.
If you're listening to today's, you already know when yesterday's came out.
There it is. The anticipation for you is just,
it doesn't matter, it's already,
it's sort of like the anticipation of what's happening in the movie right now with the very listless they're approaching
forward.
All right, so let's jump into it. Minute 67, Sean, tell us what's going on.
All right, we start minute 67 with gorillas guarding penned humans and ends with the cage humans trying to escape their pen.
All right, take a listen. Minute 67, Battle for the Planet of the Apes.
You did this.
For security.
Did you also raid the armory for the same reason?
For security!
Caesar! Caesar!
I order you to stop this! I order you to stop it now and release those people!
See? Aldo was right! War has come! Let's go!
As minute 67, we have a village worth of apes and humans, plus a ghost city's worth of radioactive people, no more corny. So I guess we're going to give up the search for Ricky. Although that would be funny if he just shows up at the end of the movie. He's the only one left standing.
So I have to jump into production stuff right away. I know we're doing this over Zoom because we have to. God, I miss having Sean right there when I just point at him and he just takes it. Now we're back to that Zoom thing again. I am so spoiled by being in a room with you.
I've got a lot of screens up that I've got to try to coordinate at one time.
So visually, we get shots pulling back still from the corral with the humans in it, the gorillas outside holding their weapons. Aldo steps in. Cornelius looking at, God, why did I say Cornelius? Caesar looking. We get shots of little baby humans inside the corral. The two leaders, I guess you could say, fight, and the humans watch on. They get beat back by some gorillas. Then we see the big boom moment when they shoot, the mutants shoot into Ape City, blowing up one of the huts, and we get chaos. So beginning with, I think probably the most pertinent thing we have to do is jump right into the conversation between Caesar and Aldo. You get Aldo basically, you know, to an extent, he's kind of right, you know? He needed it for security, and it's going to prove him even more right within just a few seconds.
No, no. Do not correlate causation with... wait, is it correlation and causation? Those are two different things. Just because he stole guns and humans showed up at the same time doesn't mean if he didn't have the guns, the humans wouldn't have showed up. I mean, he broke the law. He broke the rules.
He did.
And humans showed up. That humans that he knew nothing was going to happen until, you know, one guy got beat up 5 minutes ago and showed up and said humans are coming.
I guess I'm a little confused by... Maybe I missed something. Did Caesar get told at some point that they raided the armory? Or is he just gleaning that because he's seen... Obviously, the gorillas are holding the weapons. But shouldn't that have been the point of Virgil's, I know what you'll see, and we see them with weapons, and then that's how you get there. But it's just sort of an out-of-the-blue comment. He's not heard that information.
Agreed, but we did make that, you know, Sean pointed out that he did that thing where he continued his sentence from you know, transporting from one place in time to another. Surely they had some conversation leading up to that point that
explained, Mandamus and everything. Yeah.
I mean, you know, he hopped on a cell phone and texted Mandamus and found out that broke.
Maybe it's one of those things where Caesar saying to himself, I can't believe this unless I see it with my own eyes. And then that's when Virgil goes, there, that's what I know.
I think we're just supposed to make some, you know, this is the kind of movie where we just kind of make some leaps that you would follow this logic here without having to have that entire conversation, I guess. But you're right. I mean, we should have had something. What I was kind of bothered by was the shot itself, because we should be getting some tense moments between Caesar and Aldo, but instead we're getting Caesar and from like his clavicle up in a wide shot with Aldo, who happens to be a little bit taller than him, from his like nips up, and they're like in the front foreground a little bit, but it's wide, so we're getting all of the, it just doesn't, there's no tension in the moment of them two confronting one another, because it's just such crappy shot.
I think the name of this episode should be Aldo from the Nips Up.
It's funny, I already named it Nips Up. As soon as he said that,
you know what I'm talking about.
That might have been deliberate to make Aldo look a little more powerful than Caesar. You know, Caesar smaller.
We didn't need the camp behind them. We could have had a tense moment between.
What's
the
bad about the shot is, for me, is if you look at the guards. I mean, they're just kind of beating the fence. How is that intimidating / hurting the humans that are back there? All the humans have to do is take two steps back and they're fine.
That is true. I didn't even think about that. They're not being pressed. Now, if there were tons of them in there and they had nowhere to go.
Yeah, if they couldn't move around, or if there were more ape guards, or if they had like bayonets on the end of the guns, and they were like, maybe you see somebody got stabbed in the arm or something. But as the shot stands, it's just them hitting the fence is to make people move back. It's because they're screaming for Caesar.
My bigger problem with it, and look, this is logistical. You put a corral out in the open, the sun's coming down on it, mm-hmm. but you put your two conflicting personalities in shade, and they're almost secondary. Your eye is drawn 100% to the beating at the corral, which is fine. That may be what they want me to look at, but at that same time, you know, to Richard's point about the selection of shots, there's almost no tension between these two. It doesn't work. It doesn't pay. And especially, you know, you need that when you're going to have the next thing you have happen be a boom. Now, let's get to the boom. I don't know that I need the weird shot that looks like Culp has turned and he has a cannon penis.
explodes. Yeah, it had that kind of, what is it? Is that a lens flare kind of thing?
Yeah.
With the sun coming down, the smoke coming through?
Yeah. Yeah.
I thought it was an interesting shot, but we didn't stick with it long enough to have any meaning towards it, right? That should have been something when he was first coming up on the encampment, you know, when he was going to tell them to, you know, hurry up about it. You know what I mean?
Well, like, you know, let's be honest. You know, Culp with a half-cheek squeak sitting there on the with the cannon blowing up should have blown him off the car. He should have been flying.
Well, what I think is kind of weird is that, you know, again, let's go back to this whole idea of the bomb that's tucked away on the train somewhere. Usually when that bomb explodes, you know, with the final thing we'll get is the shot of the little second hand clicking up, and we know it's got about 10 seconds and then they cut away and then you get a boom. You don't need to show the click boom. You don't have to do that. I don't know why you need to see the cannon. We already know they're coming. If it had been a boom over their shoulders, it's scarier. You don't know that boom's coming. It just felt so anticlimactic. It's funny because I'm calling for the thing of why isn't Caesar being told they raided the armory? And yet here we get exactly what I've called for. We need the more, you know, this happens, that happens. It's too much. It's too literal for me.
You almost need to see like Mandamus stringed up somewhere, not dead, but just kind of like in the first Planet of the Apes where they had the big X things. You have him strung up there, and then Aldo's like, and you know, Caesar goes, you know, ape does not kill ape, and Aldo goes, he's still alive, isn't he? And stuff like that.
Right. I do like that it is a rocket or shell fire that interrupts the argument between
I do
the
too.
Two of them. I did appreciate that. But I do think you could have had built, again, we talk about tension. We didn't need Culp setting up the barricade and telling everybody to hurry about it in the scene where Caesar is, you know, in the in his room weeping about Cornelius, his house weeping about Cornelius. It would have been better if we know they're approaching and these two people are fighting. And you're just like, oh, shit, guys, come on. Hey, bigger things. Mutants are almost there. Hey. Guess what? Culp's setting some stuff up. What are you guys doing? You're wasting our time. We're about to fight. Come on. And then the explosion interrupts the actual argument itself. I don't know. I would have liked to have had that kind of go on in the side background while this is happening, as opposed to happen before.
Going back to what we were talking about, the cage yesterday, or even today, you know, where it's not very full. There's not many people in there. If we'd had something that was like Game of Thrones, Battle of the Bastards, where that cage is full,
yes.
So people can't move around, and then the explosion happens right near the cage, and then you see the people trying to get out, and they're climbing on top of each other, and then the apes are trying to beat them back. But no, in this case, you know, it's just, you know, we can all have plenty of room to try to get out of the cage. Nobody worry about it.
So, they could have just as easily, you know, they're in Hollywood. They could have easily set this up somewhere for like, I don't know, the Price is Right line, and have everybody kind of like crowd around that and like,
or make the cage
offer free tickets or something like that. Yeah, or a cage mall works too.
So to the events that occur over about the last 20 seconds, there's an explosion at 45 seconds that happens kind of in a field. And I'm curious if that was taken out of sequence, because right beside it are two what look like dead apes, already dead now, or maybe that's just one. But there's a body laying on the ground right there. And I can't help but wonder if this wasn't something they thought, oh, we need another boom. We need something to happen. So they grabbed it thinking nobody would notice it. And then the big thing, too, with the corral, if you're in a battle, isn't it a good idea to release the humans and let them fight with you?
Yeah, to help with you, yeah. But although I think it's going, maybe they're working with these humans. And so I was looking at my notes, and here's one of the you talking about him getting the guns for security and the human showing up. So Aldo was right. War has come, and that's because Caesar had gone to the dead city. But if Caesar never did that for whatever reason, what would Aldo's justification be for wanting these guns? Because the only reason the mutants are coming is because Caesar came to their city. If Caesar never came to their city, he, Aldo, wants the guns because he hates the humans that are in the city, or what? Because as far as we know, there's been a peace with the mutant city for the last 12 years or so. So what is Aldo's impetus for weapons outside of the fact that if Caesar hadn't gone to the dead city, there would be no army attacking them right now? What does he want the guns for?
Because
that is his character. That is what guerrillas are supposed to do. Guerrillas are supposed to be bad and evil.
Guns
and
are that's power.
Aldo is not nuanced in this. And the guerrillas are not nuanced in this particular society at all.
I mean, yeah, they need to make it where, you know, Aldo was operated on medically for testing, and he says you can never trust any humans. They're all the same. You know, he has a blind eye. This is what they did to me, or something like that.
I'm just kind of surprised they didn't have the guns already. I don't know why that wasn't a thing. I found the Caesar trying to order him. I order you to do this. And I'm like, okay, are you king? Have we definitely decided that you're the leader king and you can just kind of dictate this stuff?
Yeah.
Well, with all this said, we're at least finally in a battle. Things are starting to kick off. So, you know, can we at least say that hopefully we're turning the corner to something exciting, right?
Yes, guns are shooting at this point.
Guns are shooting. Man, nips up or guns are shooting? I think I'll go with nips up.
Nips up.
Do you guys have any other notes you want to bring in, or can we call this
nips up for Harambe?
I'm good.
All right. Well, we will be back tomorrow where we will certainly break down a lot of chaos that is happening between all these crazy apes and these mutants on the march. So for Richard and Sean, I'm Todd. Everyone have a great day.
Bye.
Bye, everybody. The Minute of the Apes.